What will you do to address the lost years in education due to the pandemic? Already, people are, experts are calling the past 2 years as the lost years, and there's a lot of catching up that needs to be done. What are you going to do about it?
One of the things that we'd like is developing, for example, our third leg is called Matatag na Bayan, no? And I believe that the foundation of a resilient nation is not just structures and policies, but actually a people. So what we'd like to do is raise up what they call the National Volunteer Corps of ages between 18 to 35. We'd like to challenge our young people, well, millennials technically, to be able to give at least 1 or 2 years of their lives to civil engagement. One of the things we'd like to do is that to send them to communities and help them and challenge them to help teach mastery of the three R's. You know, reading, writing, arithmetic. They might not have gone through, much school classroom time may have been lost, but they can certainly learn the practical concepts. And we'd like them to teach it in the mother tongue so that the concepts are received and taken, and not just in English first, because it's ridiculous. You teach them in English, but they don't even have a clue. They can't even do Tagalog, you know. So let's do mother tongue. And then teach the concepts, teach them well, teach them clearly, and then it can be translated later, but definitely mastery. A second thing that we'd like to do is, you know, during those early academic years, the years that they have lost, this is a time when they have hero worship, right? They have idol, you know, that's when they begin to idolize people. So we'd like to ask to challenge these National Volunteer Corps, this NAVO Corps guys, to be able to provide the kuya ate image, that a healthy kuya ate image that would help them, that would help the younger generation to be inspired so that they can dream that things are possible and things can be done.
Next topic, Secretary Abella.
Foreign policy.
Foreign policy. You know, President Duterte's independent foreign policy that was widely welcomed in the beginning until it turned out to be an independent foreign policy that's more of a pivot to China. How will your foreign policy look like?
I think independent foreign policy is an excellent position, especially given that, for example, the geopolitics in this area, where there are two great powers. I would maintain that we need to continue dancing in between, and need to learn in the meantime, take full advantage of this, whatever space that we have, in order to build up ourselves economically, security-wise, and even our domestic condition. Why? Because, like I said, a resilient nation, a truly firm nation, is a nation that has learned confident national identity. So we need to be able to learn how to engage in trade, let's say, with China, how to continue to work with, let's say, the U.S. in terms of alliances, in terms of the things that we, in terms of the treaties that we've entered into, and also to be able to learn how to work, let's say, with the European Union and other such nations.
But when you talk about the West Philippine Sea, for example, would you go into bilateral arrangements with other claimant countries, even if it's frowned upon by China?
That's something that's worth considering. Of course, we'd like to continue with the ASEAN plus one, but also I believe we can have a strategic cooperation, let's say, with countries with other claimants. Why? Because it could help us in terms of being able to take full advantage of our economic rights.
Next topic, Mr. Secretary.
Corruption, crime and corruption.
All right. These are, as you know, these are not separate and distinct. In the Philippines, corruption has become a tool to protect criminals both in and out of government. How will you break the ties that bind the two?
It's not going to be easy, but I believe the social pressure that civil society can bring is going to be necessary. You know, people power, it took how many days to change the political landscape? Given 6 years, I believe if people continue to participate, engage in local politics, I think we can substantially change or make headway into addressing crime and corruption.
President Duterte promised to end corruption. Clearly, that hasn't happened. Where did he go wrong, and how will he do differently?
I don't know if he went wrong in that case, but I think giving a deadline is a little bit drastic. If you say 6 months, you know, it's a little bit drastic. But I believe that I would go by the full engagement with civil society. Civil society should be able to engage in these matters.
As you know, best.
But I'm sorry, but I also believe in subsidiarity, meaning to say local solutions, local problems, local solutions. And so what works for one place might not work for another place. And that is where we need tutukan. We need to be able to really truly focus on what could work and what would not work.
As you know, Secretary Abella, the president is being investigated for crimes against humanity at the ICC. Should you win as president, will you protect President Duterte, or will you hold him to account?
We will protect citizens. ICC is not a court of first resort. It is a court of last resort. Our justice system in the Philippines works. At least we assume it does, you know. So I would say that first, let us give priority to what we do, and that is part of our sovereignty.
Next topic, Secretary.
All right. Climate change, yeah.
All right. Should you win as president, Secretary Abella, will you end the country's dependence on fossil fuels and coal-based plants and push for renewable sources of energy?
Definitely. In fact, that's part of our agricultural mega-industry plan, that renewable should really be definitely part of our project. Why? Because especially in the Mindanao area, you cannot wait for them to set up the lines. For example, we would encourage a lot of microgrids where they could act so that they can, they can almost immediately enjoy light and power, renewable solar energy. That would be excellent. So that they would have lights in their local barangays, and if they had extra, they could sell it. So it could work both ways. I'm not saying it will, they can immediately sell, but it could work.
This is the next question is something close to your heart as well, given that you were also an agri entrepreneur, if I'm not mistaken. Climate change, Mr. Secretary, is also threatening food security. What is your plan regarding that to make sure that the Philippines will be food secure?
Definitely, we want to back up our agri-industry. We want to build an agricultural ecosystem. And that is where we would, for example, make sure that, for example, our agriculture is from upstream to downstream is actually addressed. No? Research and development, manufacturing, we'd like to go through that, down to the actual helping our local farmers by purchasing their products at fair and adequate farm gate prices, and then help them market, provide them with agricultural community centers where, even if they're artisanal farmers or whether they're medium scale farmers, not necessarily immediately big scale farmers, then they could actually access tractors, trucks, so that, these build roads can be used not just by traders, but by farmers actually selling their products. They can have access to trucks, they can have post-harvest facilities, they can have cold storage plants, especially for those who are fishing. And then all the way to processing so we can sell whatever is extra.
While we're on the topic, let's talk about Malampaya. What do you think about the deal? Do you think it serves a national interest?
If it needs to be re-examined, it can be re-examined. But all I can say is this, Malampaya and other natural resources could be the source of a sovereign wealth fund, and that is what I'm interested in, to make sure that we have a sovereign wealth fund so that we can use it for two things. Number one, so that we can use it for our social safety nets. And secondly, so that we can actually invest in we can actually have capital for industrial development. It is very important that we develop our sovereign wealth fund.
Yeah, but you're running out of time when you talk about the Malampaya reserves, because that's going to get depleted soon.
But on the other hand,
will you have for the sovereign wealth fund? Go ahead.
Hey, you know, there are other things that could add. But the other thing that the other source for the sovereign wealth fund would be the underspent monies that, you know, like, for example, there are billions that are underspent and go back to the treasury. We can actually use that. In fact, in one of my readings, I found out that we have more reserve funds in Canada. I mean, isn't that a little bit ironic? It's a little bit ironic that we have more money than that. And it's rather a crime that we have so much money and then people go to bed hungry. I think we should be able to use these things for social safety nets.
All right. Now, last two topics.
Yes. Okay. The pandemic.
Okay. By the time President Duterte leaves office, Philippine debt will be at a little over 13 trillion pesos. Do you think the funds were used wisely, the debt that was incurred, and how they were spent? Let's go with that first.
I don't know if it's within my remit to be talking about whether it's wrong or what, whether they did. The way I see it, they acted according to their best lights, given the knowledge that they had during that particular time. But I would say that the pandemic itself is at a cycle. It's at a cycle and it's about to go. It probably is ending, quote unquote, probably is ending. And so I would really devote more time to helping people with their health, increasing immune systems, making sure that people are healthier.
Don't see anything wrong with the formerly supply deals?
I would let the justice go through it. You know, I would let the law take its full course and address those things.
How will you repay the debt while assuring economic recovery will be swift?
Well, if you approach it like a businessman, you don't need to be afraid of debt. What you need to be scared of is if you don't have control over the money. So if you borrow money, it doesn't matter how large it is. The most important thing is that you're in control during the length of the debt terms, no? So that if, for example, if you know where the money is going, you don't know it's being, you know that it's not being corrupted, then you can use the money effectively and the debts can be paid.
Hmm. All right. Globally, there is this movement to tax the wealthy. Are you in favor of that? Will you also do that? Should you win the presidency?
You know, eventually, I think those who get more should pay more, you know, but at the end of the day, I mean, it's a question of compassion. You know, it's a question of being able to, if living within a community of people. You know, you can't eat the rest of the, you know, 90% of the pie while 90 people are watching you eat, you know. So the other thing is I would really give attention to making sure that our tax collection is more effective.
Mm. How do you get the rich to participate, though?
Talk with them.
And what will you say?
Help out.
Are you in favor of the amendments to the Public Service Act? Do you see this as a means to boost post-pandemic recovery efforts?
Which one? Which in particular?
The Public Service Act.
Which is?
This is the act that's now pending, wherein it's now going to be allowed a full ownership, or the state is now going to allow full ownership of certain utilities that are not considered public utilities. What do you think about that?
Well, just as long as the public, you know, for example, our public wealth, water, are continue to be in the protective umbrella of the government. I can see we can be opening up more and more to foreign investment, but just as long as it doesn't deeply hurt, it doesn't hurt our locals.
So what are the foreseeable ramifications if we go down that route?
I would say we would need to take it step by step. For example, agriculture. For example, I would set up a board of agricultural investments, no, to make sure, for example, that you know, for example, Department of Agriculture would be handling the technical side. The Board of Agricultural Investments, for example, would look after the business side, the entrepreneurial side. And I would like a financial expert or management expert to be able to be part of this. You know, we'd like greater participation from experts.
All right. Final topic, Marcos. Yes. You know, Secretary Abella, he's not just a candidate in the elections. He's not just a contender. He's also a campaign issue. Why do you think this is so?
Well, as far as I can see, people are raising up matters like disqualification, stuff like that. So I would say that, but I would say that the whole issue about the Marcoses is about the history, and the people are concerned that the history is being rewritten, and that is a valid concern.
What's more important to you then, that you win, or that a Marcos is prevented from occupying the palace once again?
I need to choose my battles.
You need to choose your
battles. My battles.
What do you mean by that?
Well, it all depends on what am I going to devote myself to. You know, if I believe that this is a calling, then I should devote myself to this calling to make sure that we win, for example. And not because it's just a question of winning, but to be able to set the right directions, which we think is possible, and that the Philippines could change that way.
What do you think would it take to put the Marcos issue to rest? Actually, should it even be put to rest?
Are you asking that it should be put to rest through elections or through their
personal? Not just the elections, but the whole issue about martial law, about their family, about the atrocities committed during the Marcos regime.
Actually, what has always been in my mind is a truth commission. In which a situation where the people who are involved can actually voice their concern, and people who they are referring to should actually voice their response. And then let's try to find out if we say let's just move on, I believe old wounds need to heal, and that needs to be properly addressed.
All right, Mr. Secretary. Okay. Yeah. And Mr. Secretary, you reached the end of our interview, but before we let you go, some rapid fire questions, quick answers to quick questions. First thing that comes to mind. So let's begin. Last book you read?
2034. It's a book about the Third World War involving China.
Last text message you sent, and to whom?
To Sarah, asking if she sent the link to the ANC meeting.
What's your playlist like?
It's left to right. I have classical music, I have Baroque, I have Kanye, I have...
You have Kanye?
Yeah, why not?
Cool. Are you a morning person or a night owl?
Oh, definitely I'm a morning person, very early in the morning.
Last show you streamed or binge-watched?
That was some time ago, but I think it was... what is that thing?
Matrix.
No. You remember billions, but it's...
Oh, billions.
Billions.
Okay. I thought you were going to say Matrix. I mean, that's a long time ago. You've donned many hats, Mr. Secretary. If you would pick a favorite, which one would it be? Pastor, businessman, newspaper columnist, college professor, or Duterte spokesman?
The one I'm wearing now, presidential.
Presidential candidate. All right. And if you win, you're going to be needing your very own spokesperson. If you only had two choices, who would it be? Harry Roque or Sal Panelo?
Neither.
Which survey house is the most credible?
I'm not sure, but, I kind of look at Publicos.
If the need to abolish one agency arises, which one would it be and why?
An agency at the executive office?
Any agency.
I can't really think of anything at this stage.
If you were to form an alliance with one of your presidential rivals, who would it be?
That hasn't really come to mind yet.
Who was your top pick for a running mate?
I don't have a top pick for a running mate because I didn't consider that. I just felt that I was responsible only for myself.
What did working for the Duterte administration teach you?
To learn how to put aside one's ego.
Person you'd love to meet, dead or alive?
I would like to meet the couple, the Banerjee and Duflo, the economics, the couple that won the Nobel Prize 2019.
And what would you tell them?
I would ask them about their, about inequality. I would ask them about their study on economic inequality and how it happens, what could be done.
Who is your personal hero?
Personal hero? Honestly, I'm kind of sentimental. My hero are my folks.
That's the best heroes one could have. Best president we never had.
Magsaysay? Well, we had him for a while, you know. But I think he really connected.
Finally, you just found out you won the elections. First thought that comes to mind.
Thank God.
Former Duterte spokesperson Ernesto Abella, thank you for joining us today. You take care and keep safe. Nice to see you.
Nice to see you, Carmina. Thank you very much.